And I'm delighted to welcome Ambassador Luqman Feili here, he's the ambassador of Iraq, to talk about the Iraqi elections taking place on April 30th. Ambassador Feili has been here for about 9 months. Prior to this, he served as Japan's ambassador, I'm sorry, as Iraq's ambassador to Japan, and spent many years in the UK studying to be an engineer when it was not safe to be in Iraq. Speaking of not safe, Ambassador Feili is a veteran. He ran the Boston Marathon 2 days ago. So when he comes, and he completed the Boston Marathon 2 days ago. So when he comes up, please give him extra time to make it up the stairs. But he will make it up, and we're delighted to see you. We look forward to what you have to say. After Ambassador Feili talks, he and I will have a discussion for about 15 minutes, and then we'll open it up to the group for questions. So please join me in welcoming Ambassador Luqman Feili.
Allowing us to have an opportunity to chat among friends about the situation in Iraq. I will talk about 10, 15 minutes if that's okay.
Perfect.
And then we'll have the Q&A session. I think to start with, let me say that I'm privileged to be here today. First, because of the new magnificent facility and building which CSIS have acquired, and B, for being talking about Iraq, an area which may have not been talked about for some time in DC following the troop withdrawal. But I think it's important that we provide some opportunities to discuss among friends as to what are taking place in Iraq, in the region, and more importantly, where does the United States see itself as a key player and partner in Iraq. And within that context, I think the CSIS has played an important role. And John, thank you for chairing that part of the CSIS, the Middle East program. And there, I think you all guys are in a safe hand. So
thank you.
Appreciative of that. Only 2 days ago, as John mentioned, I ran in the Boston Marathon in honor of the and in support of the victims of terrorism from Baghdad to Boston. I'm proud that I finished. I'm relieved that I'm finished as well. And I have the tremendous respect and appreciation to those who completed the race following last year's tragic terroristic act. Iraq's journey from despotism to democracy is also a marathon. Only 1 week from today, or actually on the April 30th, the Iraqi parliamentary election will mark a milestone of on our progress and serves as an attribute to the sacrifices of so many Iraqis and Americans and other countries that helped us to stay in the course of democracy. This will be the fourth parliamentary election since the overthrow of Saddam Hussein back in 2003. And the first since the US withdrawal of troops at the end of 2011. Amidst regional turmoil, instability, and sectarian polarization, this election offers us the opportunity to consolidate democracy, nurture greater stability, and strengthen national unity. Democracy means that the people can elect leaders on their own choosing. In this election, Iraqis will be able to choose among over 9,000 candidates from 117 political entities competing for 328 parliamentary seats. Let me repeat that. 9,000 candidates, 107 blocs, political parties actually, or entities, forgive me, and 328 seats. We want the composition of the parliament to represent the diversity of the people. 25% of the seats in parliament are allocated to women. Christians and other minorities are guaranteed a certain number of seats in order to ensure their representation in parliament. 60% of the 21.5 million eligible voters are expected to turn out, around 60%. Out-of-country voting will take place in 19 nations. Here in the United States, the process is being administered by the Independent High Electoral Commission, an independent body of 9 commissioners nominated and approved by the Parliament. Throughout the nation, only 15 candidates have been barred by the Commission. There has been much less controversy than in the past elections about excluding candidates and about debathification. To ensure accountability and transparency, electronic voting cards are being used in order to eliminate or to reduce voting frauds. More than 650 credentials have been issued to foreign monitors. These improvements help to explain why 75% of Iraqis are more enthusiastic about this election than earlier elections, according to a recent poll commissioned by NDI, National Democratic Institute. As the campaign enters its closing week, Americans would find some features familiar. The campaign are better organized and more professional than in the past, reflecting increasing the numbers of Iraqis who are online. The candidates are making greater use of social media to reach out to constituents and debate core issues. What are the issues? Well, I have heard the famous American slogan, it's the economy, stupid. In Iraq, the economy is one of four overriding concerns. Security concerns are inescapable. Most Iraqis believe that security can improve if Iraqi forces are better armed and trained. Regarding the economy, surprisingly, most Iraqis don't see the oil sector as the major driver for growth and prosperity. Instead, Iraqis believe that the two things our nation needs are loans for small businesses and incentives to business owners to hire more employees. Rounding out their major concerns, Iraqis want to rebuild and improve our education and healthcare systems. Now, it is no secret that the election is being held amidst the rising threat of terrorism. Groups such as so-called ISIL or Daesh, that is why it is more important than ever that the elections are held on time. When they participate in the election, the voters will be striking a powerful blow against the terrorists who are trying to frighten us away from the polling places in order to prevent the consolidation of democracy in Iraq. Making no mistake, every vote that is cast will be a vote for hope and not fear. Ballots and not bullets, and democracy and not dictatorship or divisiveness. When the final results are released, which is expected to be by the end of May, the democratic process will continue. Since it is possible that no single party gains a majority, the conversations will continue about how the competing parties can come together to form a coalition government. An inclusive government will keep Iraq moving forward towards security, stability, and democracy. And we want all three. Having been ruled by one man and one party under Saddam's regimes, Iraqis understand that no single faction, whether political, ethnic, regional, or religious, should control or can't control their country. When every segment of society has a voice and no community feels excluded, the new government will gain legitimacy. Let me repeat that. When every segment of society has a voice and no community feels excluded, the new government will gain legitimacy. This will deny the extremists the political support they need for their violent tactics. Inclusiveness isn't only the best way to building democracy, it is also the best and only way to beat terrorism. As we succeed at holding elections and forming a new government, we will be better able to make progress on the security, political, economic, and diplomatic fronts. In the southern provinces throughout the election campaign, there have been no reported security incidents in Muthanna, Diwaniya, and Najaf. In the western provinces, improved security will depend on the speed of process of forming the new government. Despite the current difficulties in Anbar, the government is committed to ensuring conditions for a strong voter turnout. Displaced persons will be able to cast their votes at secure sites. On the political front, the process of forming a government will be conditioned on reaching an agreement with key segments of our society, such as the Kurds over the oil revenue and the scope of federalism, among other issues. We are hopeful that following the election, the odds will improve for breaking that deadlock. This in turn will pave the way for a greater focus on trade and investment. On the diplomatic front, successful elections will improve Iraqi's standing in the international community. This will enable us to play a greater role in the region as a force for moderation. Forming a new government will also re-energize the implementation of the Strategic Framework Agreement, which was signed between the United States and Iraq. We want to build what President Obama has called a partnership of equals. As part of that endeavor, our embassy will continue our efforts to promote institutional and people-to-people exchange between Iraqis and Americans. When you visit Iraq, you will find an energetic and educated people committed to building our democracy, securing our country, stabilizing our region, and rebuilding our roads, highways, and airports, restoring our water and electrical systems, and improving our education and healthcare. We welcome American partnership, friendship, and investment. The marathon we are running is long, but we are determined to cross the finish line despite the challenges we face. Let me thank you again for giving me the opportunity to be here, and I will be more than happy to take in any Q&A question. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. One of the things that is curious sitting in the United States watching these elections is I haven't seen any coverage of alternatives to Prime Minister Maliki winning re-election. There don't seem to be other political personalities that are being reported on. There don't seem to be political movements that have a reasonable chance of winning a plurality. Could you just help us understand, we all know Prime Minister Maliki. Mm-hmm. He's been there, he's been to Washington. Who are some of the other candidates who are either likely to be serious contenders or likely to be the ones whose decisions will shape the consequences of the elections?
Okay. In Iraq, we have somewhat of a stranger system of government. We're not like the British system in the sense that the member of parliament will become prime minister, keep their parliamentary seats, and every party put their candidates forward. That's not the case. We also have a situation in which the dynamic of electing the prime minister is totally different to the dynamic of voting. Let me explain this to you. For example, you have the populace elect their representation at parliament. However, once the parliamentarians are there, the formation of the government is on who's best able to collect the votes of the parliamentarians, not of the people. So you have two different dynamics altogether for the premiership to be elected than for the parliamentarian to be elected, because the parliamentarian choose the premiership. You have also a culture in which there are very few red lines between the blocs as to what to give and not to give, and which makes it a bit complicated for the formation of the government, a prolonged process, and more importantly, candidacy will not be put forward until the election is complete. So you don't have even blocs, forget about the, within the state of law, other blocs. I'm not aware of anybody putting a name forward and say, this is my candidacy. Although they have said, we will secure or we will endeavor to gain the premiership or lead the prime minister government formation. Why? Because they think that they will undermine their candidacy by declaring the names between now and the election, for primarily for tactical reasons. That's the key issue.
I mean, one way to read that would be that putting a name forward, if they think that the prime minister is likely to be reelected, they'd rather be in the coalition rather than against it. I mean, I just remember in the last election.
That was the same, no, John, that was the same scenario in 2009.
But we had Iyad Alawi, right, who won more seats than the Maliki coalition.
Yes.
And he was clearly running, and he clearly didn't win.
Yes.
Because he was unable
exactly
to form a government.
That's my point. The point is the formation of the government following the election is different than the than electing your representative.
Right.
Because the challenge each party have, can they gather enough votes, can they entice other blocs to form up a coalition to form the government? That's the key challenge.
So speaking politically, it seems to me that gives tremendous advantage to incumbency, because the incumbent prime minister would have tremendous tools at his disposal to build a coalition. And the dynamic outside that coalition would be, how do I get in, rather than how do I assemble an alternative coalition? Is that
to a fair certain reading extent, of that? I think you're right to a certain extent. Okay. That, however, you also have an issue of no premiership is secure. So halfway through the last government, there was a challenge to the prime ministers. No confident vote. And they were more or less there. So in a way, that's what the democratic process of Iraq is. People have been talking about moving on to the presidential situations and others. I think we're somewhat far from that. But also, Iraqis have historically used to the presidential system. So you have a cultural issue as well. So that's a problem. Let me give you another example. The prime minister's position, according to the constitution, is head of the cabinet. And his vote is one. And he has no authority of laying people off, or whether they're cabinet members or others. He has to go to the parliament. So his power is different. The actual people who put up who voted for the constitution were sure about separating the powers in a way, and this is what's taking place in Iraq. So at the cabinet level, prime minister's vote is one among many.
Right.
He has no veto. He has no extra weight or anything else. So we're going through a new dynamic of Iraqi democracy, and this is the key issue which I hope people appreciate.
The Dexter Filkins article in the New Yorker,
which I'm yet to finish reading. So
well, wait. Let me give away the ending. Yeah. The ending is this.
I saw Dexter before, so I know what the ending is.
The ending is that they quote Emma Skye, saying that one of the tragedies of the Iraqi political system is the prime ministership is too weak. I'm sorry, maybe it's too strong. Anyway, she and Ryan Crocker are opposed, and one of them says,
yeah,
the prime ministership is too strong. The other says the problem is prime ministership is too weak.
Yeah, I think I know both, I've spoken to both extensively about these issues. Let me project to you my analysis of it. You have a new political process forming in Iraq. You have a new dynamics taking place. You have a culture which is not known to democracy in the whole region, not just in Iraq. You have a 3 or 4 generations of militarization of the society. So there, the issue of what is the perceived power versus actual power is very important. The issue of symbolism in Iraq is very important. So that's another issue. For example, people were saying, well, the president is no longer there because of his illness. Was that the president position? I mean, people are now saying, for example, the presidency, should that be a Kurd because the previous president was a Kurd? Or no, the previous president has the aura and has the personality to bring everybody. And that's why it's unique. You with me? So it's to do with the personality impact of us. And in our own culture, in the whole Middle Eastern culture, the personality is very important. It's not the actual power authority or the legitimacy, it's a personality issue. And we're trying to move away from that to safeguard us. And this is what I was talking about.
Okay. The Hausa, the sort of clerical establishment in Iraq, has traditionally urged people to vote and traditionally tried to keep the Shia community unified to protect Shia interests. And it's not been active in this round of elections. In your judgment, is that a good thing or a bad thing?
They have actually been very active in their weekly summons, in which they focus primarily on the caliber of the candidacy, their displeasure with services provided to the people. So they've tried to keep away from personalizing the issue because they were labeled that they intervened in the first government formation, and therefore they thought that they should not take the baggage of that any longer, and they should disassociate themselves. Historically, Hausa, especially the Sistani school of thought, Ayatollah Sistani school of thought, have never been involved in politics historically. But following the 2003 situation, following the lack of visible leaders, following the dynamics, the challenges of Iraq, they start being, people ask them to promote that more guardian role. And which I think they have played a very positive role, to be honest. They have been very stable, very mature, totally opposite end of sectarianism, totally opposite end of polarizing the society, inclusion has been their theme. So they have been a very good player there. Now, in this election, they have been advocating for participation, they've been advocating for the caliber of the parliamentarians, and they're kept away from personalizing the issue, which I think is a very nice position, very healthy position for a major religious, or I can't even call it a cultural institution, to promote.
One of the really troubling things we've seen in Iraq in the last 6 months is it seems that sectarian violence is ticking up again, thousands of deaths this year. Can you paint a picture of an electoral result which actually helps address some of the sectarian divisions, or is it outside of electoral consequences? Is there a way that this election could or is likely to lead to a decrease in sectarian tension, sectarian violence?
The election within democratic systems are the reboot button for resolving and re-energizing societies, and we are certainly looking for that. Nobody is saying the election is coincidental or marginal. They're saying it's essential for the serious discussion to take place after the election, to address core issues, which is to do with centralization, decentralization, power of provinces, disbursements of the budgets, oil law, and so on. So in that sense, the election will provide us or will re-energize us in having that discussion, a fresh view with people who are just being given the mandate by the vote of the people. That's one aspect. The other aspect of it is no single party, no single bloc is saying I need to dominate or I need to have a full authority of the formation of the government in at the cabinet level or other representation issue. So everybody's saying we need to get the buy-in of the Kurds, we need to get the buy-in of the Sunnis, we need to get the buy-in of the majority of the Shia, as if you're looking at it from that binary way. Or we need to get the majority of religious establishment, or we need to get moderate voices involved, or we need to get the professional involved in the government. So they're talking about, for example, the ministers. They're saying we need to move away from leaders of the parties being their own minister. We need to get professional people involved in it. Or we need to bring people in who can work with each other, and the prime minister or others need to have a bit more power or say in who his team should be, which is all to do with effectiveness and efficiency of governing. And these are all good news. The election is the only way we're approaching it. I'm not aware of any specific party saying it has to be us who gets 51% plus to form the government. That's not possible.
Although you certainly have Sunnis who feel systematically excluded from the process.
But they have representation in the government. They want to have representation in the cabinet level. So let me address the issue you talked about before, which you just mentioned, which I think will address this question as well. What you have now is not the scenario of 2005, 6, 7, or 8. You don't have turf war. You don't have a neighborhood fighting each other. You don't have the ethnic cleansing you had before. That's no longer the case. You have people who believe in rule of law, and you have people who say this democratic process of Iraq is not working for us. This is the key issue. It's the governor of Anbar, who stood with the government, who was elected, by the way, and he's as Sunni as anybody can be, who stood by the government against the Daesh and others in Fallujah and Rumadi, is a Sunni. Surely him or others should have a say in governing in future Iraq. And we will welcome that. Nobody is expecting to dominate or to exclude other. It won't work. The Constitution will not allow it. It's not the 51%. It's 60% or 63%. Because of the presidency requires for the government, for the process to kick in, you need to select a president. And that won't take place unless you are more or less confident about the premiership, because you have a period of 30 days, which means two-thirds of the parliament have to agree. It's not the actual 51%. It's two-thirds of the parliament have to agree to kick-start the process again.
I hope you have an easier time getting two-thirds of your parliament to agree than we have with our Congress. Tony Cordesman put out a report, which I'm sure you've at least glanced at, which had, I thought, some very surprising numbers right up front. Said the World Bank ranks Iraq as having extremely low quality of governance, 178th in the world in accountability, 201st in political stability and violence, 182nd in government effectiveness, 205th in the quality of rule of law, 189th in the quality of government regulation, and 193rd in the control of corruption.
He's my friend.
Tony tells it straight. But what I'm interested in your explanation of why that set of numbers can exist alongside with the fact that we see a prime minister who most people think is going to be reelected. I mean, if there's a democratic process and everybody is looking for inclusion, nobody knows how it's going to come out, how does that set of numbers not create the sense that there's going to be any alternative to the current government rather than, despite these numbers, the prime minister seems likely?
These numbers are elite numbers.
Okay.
Democracy is about the populace. The numbers, I'm not disputing them. However, one thing I know about these numbers, and I work closely with the World Bank and others, we provide full access for those numbers to be known. A lot of other countries don't even allow those numbers to be known. So in that sense, our Ministry of Oil announces every month how much oil we sold to whom, so transparency. Tell me other countries who do that. So we don't have an issue of understanding our weaknesses. We go to the World Bank. I was there 2 weeks ago with our Minister of Finance. We said to the World Bank, Bank of Governor was there. We said to them, please give us more numbers. Tell us exactly where we're going wrong, because we want to build that country. The Prime Minister issue is, again, it's to do with the populace whom they think is the right person, candidate for it. That's one aspect. People have been telling us for the last 10 years, Iraq will be divided and Iraq is going through all kinds of troubles. And I think we have proven them wrong enough for them to start thinking twice about this basic assumption of theirs. That's the second. Third point, which I fully agree with these numbers, and we're trying to do that effectively. We know we have a coalition government in which there is no opposition party. Technically speaking, there is no opposition party in Iraq. If you have 5 or 7 parliamentarians, you're eligible for ministerial or at least senior officials at one of the high commissions and others, and therefore you're part of that. That's not very effective. I would even call it inefficient. But that's the system we have chosen. And now we're trying to say, okay, let's try to be more effective and not get everybody, literally everybody, maybe get majority of people in. And that's what we're trying to do. I think this is where we're going with it. As to why the Prime Minister is popular or others is, I suspect, is that individual Iraqis look at this election as what is the only issue of importance to them. Not what are the issues of importance. One issue, which is to do with their nationalism, to do with their ID, to do with their security, for example. And they see, in that perspective, they see a prime minister who is focused on security. Whether that's right or wrong, that's for a historian to tell. But what we have is we have to expect and accept these democratic processes. It may be painful, but I think that's what we're choosing.
Last question before I go to the audience. As I was reading up all the press on Iraq and the elections, why do you think you get such a hard treatment in the press? Why do the people who seem to know Iraq seem so disappointed in what's happening?
We are still a story in the making, in as far as democracy is concerned, in as far as adhering to a constitution is concerned. You know, for the last, prior to 2003, the last constitution we had was during the Hashemite Kingdom, 58. After that, we had all transitional constitutions. So we are somewhat new for having a new social contract. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is the complexity of Iraq, and forgive me for saying that, I'm not trying to be arrogant or anything, I would say I doubt a lot of people can understand it. It's complicated because of the fault line theme of Iraq, whether it's sectarianism, energy, nationalism, having two big neighbors who are non-Arabs next door. In that aspect of it, it's difficult to understand. You also have a pride, a key theme of the people, where pride is important. However, time is irrelevant. So people try to pigeonhole us and say, how could a formation of government take 9 months? Well, it has taken 9 months. Is it right or wrong? We don't work based on the American concept of a project, which is to do with time, resources, and scope. These are the three elements you always have in mind. We don't have those correlation in similar manner, and therefore we are complicated, and sometimes I would say we are even contradictory to our character because of that complexity. That's why people are somewhat disappointed. What we say to them is, look at us as a theme. Don't look at us as individuals. Look at us as a theme. Over the last 10 years, we have evolved. Even those who are in opposition are saying we need to be opposite to the political process, not just opposite to Prime Minister Maliki, we need to be involved in this democratic process. They are saying that democracy is the only way. Nobody is advocating dictatorship any longer. So in that perspective, it's an issue. Even the prime minister, who's been accused with dictatorship, he's saying, I need the provinces to have better disbursement rate for their budget so that we decentralize more. And that call for decentralization has come from the governor of Basra, or the previous governor, who was in the same party of the prime minister, who's calling. So you see the complexity of that? That's, I think, what people have to appreciate. It's a long history. With history, you get complication. And that's what we are. Unfortunately, we're not binary.
Says the engineer.
The mathematicians, actually.
Okay. Happy to open it up to questions if you would do us all a favor by introducing yourself and perhaps asking just one question until everybody's had a chance to ask. Sir, all there in the back.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. My name is Dan Tavana from the Project on Middle East Democracy. To follow up on John's comments with the numbers that Tony Korsman cited in his report, I think we saw for the first time, especially with Iraq earlier during Prime Minister Maliki's visit, an attempt by members of Congress to condition assistance, particularly security assistance, on progress on meeting some of these indicators, or responding to them at least. Can you tell us a little bit more about how the Iraqi government viewed that effort and maybe even how it's responded to some of those impulses so far? Thanks.
We do need to keep talking and communicating with our American friends at all levels. Historically, majority of discussion has been between the White House and the government. The embassy's role, the primary role for us, we do less work on with the White House and more with Congress and others, because we think there is an urgent need for it. We've got good communication and understanding with the White House. So that was the key issue. And that was what the Prime Minister took back with him, that he, as a representative of the government, needs to work with the embassy to strengthen our relationship with the stakeholders of the United States. In the United States, the decision-making is not one single party or person, and therefore we need to have institution-to-institution relationship. Based on that, the security issue became clear to all people or parties in the United States that the danger of Daesh, the safe haven of the Anbar province and others, will be a significant risk to U.S. as much as it is to Iraq and Middle and regional instability. In that sense, I think Congress and Senate and the House and the Senate could see now that they need to work with us. We may have our own inner politics to discuss with them, fair enough. As friends, we're willing to do that. But to make it conditional, I think they know that we need urgent assistance. And we have been getting that, and we think we're on the right track.
So right here on the aisle.
Phoebe.
Phoebe, that would be you.
Thank you. Phoebe Marr, independent scholar. Thank you very much, and congratulations on the marathon.
Thank you. Dear.
I would like to get back to the election, if I may, and sort of follow up on some things you said about the inclusiveness of it. I have not heard much about how the election is going to be run in areas that are presumably almost at war, such as Fallujah, Ramadi, and so on. And how do you assess, first of all, how is the government going to doing in terms of keeping security there for the election? And how would you assess the ability of the Sunni population there to participate in the election?
That's one of the key challenges, Phoebe, we had as to where does our responsibility and the safety of the people lie. Responsibility of government of providing election and opportunity for people to participate, and the safety of the people in us not barging in Fallujah, or us not using indiscriminate or being gung-ho, that's the right word to use, in our approach to that. And that's why we've been patient, which is not in our nature, by the way. What the military are doing now, it's not in their nature. There has been a lot of urging for them to just go in, especially after the Daesh tried to close the dam and there was an issue of water flow to the south. So that's a challenge for us. So we know there is an obligation on government to provide safe environment for democratic to take place, for democracy to take place, and also we have an obligation for the security of the country as well. So that's the key challenge we've been trying to get. What we have been trying to do is those who are in displaced in Karbala, in Mosul, in Diyala provinces and others, and there are quite significant numbers there, for them to be able to vote for representative of the Rumadi province. So if you are in Karbala, you can vote for Rumadi. That's the idea of it, rather than just to vote, because currently each province votes for their own representative, so that's one aspect. The cards we've been giving, these smart cards or sort of electronic cards, sorry, not smart cards, electronic cards, we're trying to disperse it better. We're still working on that, to be honest, even a week before the election, we're still working on that. We know there will be less representation as a result of that, unfortunately. However, we're eager not to go to the 2005 scenario, where whole communities are excluded. That's an issue as well for us. So there we're trying to get the right balance between true representation versus security and safety. And it's not easy, an easy formula.
There you go.
Mr. Ambassador, thanks for your presentation. My name is Becca Smith. I'm a fellow here at CSIS. This is maybe following on John's reference to how the media treats Iraq, covers Iraq negatively. My impression is that there's a sentiment in the United States, there's a strong desire to see Iraq succeed. And Americans may feel some responsibility for success in Iraq, understanding that we pulled back and now it's your responsibility. And yet we spent a decade there and we want to know that it was worth it, both for US objectives and for Iraqis themselves. So I guess I would ask you, was it worth it to you to have the US intervention? Was it worth it to the average Iraqi citizen? What are the benefits that Iraqis may experience now, despite all the challenges that came with intervention?
As you may appreciate, when you evaluate, historians talk about evaluating situations. They try to move away from the binary element of it. Is it right or wrong? And was it worth it or not worth it? There are myriads of issues which Iraqis went through prior to 2003. The popular slogan at that time was, forgive me for saying that, they would say, let us have Sharon rule us. And to the Iraqis, that's a different perspective than anybody else, than Saddam Hussein. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is that the people used to have pride in their country. Now they were alienated internationally, more US sanctions than anybody else, Chapter 7 and everything else. Middle class, more or less, were no longer there. More or less evaporated the middle class outside the country or internally. You had the university professor doing taxi service in the evening to earn up and to supplement it. That was the extent, selling their households. So that was one aspect. The question, I think, is more for American historian than Iraqis to answer that specific US dimension of it. But for the Iraqis, we now have an opportunity for democracy. We have challenges. Nobody's underestimating that challenges. But we have a big project ahead of us. We have extremely ambitious project ahead of us. To achieve that, people want to do it in their lifetime. I think it will take generations rather than lifetime. Because of the legacy, it took generations. It's always harder to build than to demolish. In that sense, I think the United States provided us with the opportunity. Was it worth it or not to the Americans? I think I would leave that to our American colleagues to answer that and so on. But I think for Iraqis we have a chance. We have a reality we have to work with. And also, the legacy didn't help us to sustain. So even now, people are saying, well, I mean, let me give you an example. At worst case scenario in Iraq, people say, we need to be more effective. Let us have a just dictator. A just dictator. So even the dictator they had, they want him to be just, which is impossible to do. So I think this is what, so people are somewhat educated better at a cost. And we're going through that painful process. But as I said in my talk, it's a marathon. It's not a, and for someone who's done the marathon, I know it's not an easy ride.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Daniel, sir, we're from Johns Hopkins SAIS. I wonder if I could ask you to solve a problem for me. You've emphasized inclusivity as the outcome of the election. The Prime Minister has made no secret of his desire for what he calls a majoritarian government. And his campaign has frankly been a campaign of law and order, security, but very heavily focused on an appeal only to Shia. There will be very few Sunni and Kurdish votes for the Prime Minister. So how do you reconcile his campaign and his interest in a majoritarian government with what you have emphasized here, which is the importance of inclusivity?
The Prime Minister is at the end of the day, he's a politician, and he wants to be voted into power. So I don't see any contradiction or any anomaly there. And he also is fully aware that the formation of the government, you have to have the inclusivity, and you have to get other buy-ins into it. So that he's coming from that direction as well. You also have a situation in which people are saying we need to have a better sense or pace for decision making. And we can't have pull and push and between the various institutions of the government. And let me give you the anomaly which told me, let me reverse it. You have a cabinet which is more cohesive, and at the same time, a mirror image of that cabinet at the parliament which is very dysfunctional. So at the end of the day, the system depends on Parliament for legislation and monitoring. If that's somewhat dysfunctional, how would you expect the government to be effective? I think the Prime Minister is coming from that point. And it's not just the Prime Minister about it. I have not seen anybody who says we need to have a government in which every segment of Iraq and no opposition party should be forming it. Nobody's calling for that again, because everybody knows that they need to get more votes so that they have more power, so that they can become more effective in governing. Because the key question we have now is we've tried for the last 10 years to be inclusive, but also not to have anybody excluded. And I do mean that, nobody. Now we're saying this is not working for us, because of the challenges, because of the pace, decision-making, security, regional issues, and so on. And we need to be more effective in our governing. However, the Prime Minister at the same time is a politician, and he wants to get more votes. I don't see any surprises there. But can he form the government by his own bloc alone? I doubt if he even promotes that. I don't think he is aware of that. And he's saying we need to get more parties, but we need to get some of the Kurdish parties. We need to get some of the provinces parties, such as from Anbar or Mosul or Diyala or others, as much as I need to get parties from Basra to be involved in the government formation. I think this is where he's coming from. If you look at it from a pure binary way, it won't work. But if you look at it as two stages, one for the election and one for the government formation, I think it can resolve the issue for.
We only have a couple of minutes. Why don't we just pick up on that if I can.
Sure.
One of the large goals the United States had in sort of 2004, 2005 was bringing people together. What I might take from your last comment is actually if there's less solidarity in the Shia community and less solidarity in the Sunni community and less solidarity in the Kurdish community, that may actually lead to better outcomes. And it goes to what you were saying with the party formation, that there have to be people in opposition. Is perhaps one of the outcomes we should hope for out of this election is not that people come together into blocks, but that that none of the blocks prove sustainable, and there is a process by which people of all variety come together. There are lots of Shia in opposition. There are lots of Sunnis in the government, and we move into a post-sectarian organization for Iraqi politics. Is that something to hope for?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying in a way. It's necessary for us to evolve into one in which the policies are the issues, not the background or the color of your skin. That's essential for us, because we also know that let me tell you why the reasons behind that. Team building or teamwork is not a core characteristic of our people because of various other regions. And therefore, for them to form the government in bringing like what we call national
community government,
that won't work. That no longer is the case, because we have tried it. It may have been a painful process for us. It might have been a necessary process for us. Yes. But for us to be more effective in governing, to address the core issues of providing better services, the country is rich, but we need to move away from these numbers, go up the numbers, which Anthony Korsman mentioned before. People are realizing that, and they're saying we need to address these issues, and that's where we're coming from.
Mr. Ambassador, you have a busy week ahead. We've got a tiring week behind you, but a busy week ahead as you get ready for the elections. We wish you luck. We appreciate your coming to join us, and we look forward to hearing more about Iraq in the years to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Anthony. Thank you.